All right, what's up everybody? This is the first video on the channel, so I'll take a couple seconds to explain exactly what we're doing here. So this channel is a group of three of us who will be writing Medium articles and doing videos on the Medium articles in order to hopefully take some complex topics, journals, and just more interesting deep dives into quantitative finance topics that have to do with quant trading. And so we'll be covering things from machine learning to different ways to deal with your data. All the things that I feel like typically don't get explained in a video and don't get put into any type of digestible article. And so our goal is going to be to make it as easy to understand, reduce the barrier to entry, and give some insight into what to be looking for and how to get an edge, how to generate an alpha, and sort of get rid of the whole movement where everybody just posts back tests that have 10,000% return in a day to make everyone want to hop on board. Nowadays, with big companies having so much technology and money to dump into unique data sets, smart employees, and just people to look for these things, it's getting harder and harder to find an edge doing common things. And so our goal is to investigate some of these more difficult topics, make them easier, and hopefully let everyone leave with the ability to go test them out, go try it in your own way, and help you think about things differently that maybe would be tough to sit down and read through. And so the first thing we're going to do is we're looking at fractionally differencing data. And this is a topic that I was first introduced to in the Advances in Financial Machine Learning. I thought it was a great book. Some people don't love it because they don't particularly like the author and they don't find it super digestible, but I think it's a good book, and I think the topic of fractionally differencing data is also very interesting because the whole point of differencing your data is to make it stationary, and having stationary time series data, which essentially is that the mean and variance and statistical properties aren't changing over time, they're constant, is important when it comes to working with, let's say, machine learning. And so just about anyone who's ever dove into trying to make an automated trading bot, find a strategy, backtest, or really anything, has experimented with differencing their data to make it stationary. Now, what's interesting with that is when you difference your data by an order of one, which means taking the returns, it takes away all the memory. You're left with a mean, you're left with a variance, and it's really, now you have nothing that everyone else doesn't have. And the goal when you're trying to get an edge is to find things that other people can't find. And so the easier it is for everyone to do, and the easier that it is and more attempted by more people, the less likely you're going to get a real edge looking through doing that method. And so also, if you take away the memory, you're essentially taking away the bulk of what might exist to get an edge out of. So fractionally differencing data is a potential solution to doing this. And so we're going to take a look. The first thing is one of the imports we use, Y Finance. And I think that is an important import for anybody who doesn't want to go spend a ton of money on specific data, but they just want to test it out. Since it's free, it's not the best data, but we don't want any barriers to entry here. So if you haven't used it, it's worth checking it out, working with it, experimenting around. And then we're also going to be using the 80 Fuller in the stats model package because That's going to be how we test to see if something's stationary. Essentially, the AD Fuller, without going into too much detail, is checking for a unit root. The unit root, or however many, whatever that is going to tell you how many times it needs to be differenced in order for it to be stationary. And the test is assuming that it is not stationary. So the null hypothesis is that it is not stationary. And what this package will do is check for a unit root, and then it'll spit out the test statistic and it'll spit out the p-value. And it's one of the ways that you can look to see if it's stationary. You could also plot your data and visually check, or you could do any other type of test, but this is what we're going to do to keep it consistent and not just rely on visualizing. So the first thing that I do is I go in and I download the S&P future. You can download whatever you'd like. I just chose this. It's the first thing I thought of. And there's also other parameters. So you could put a start date, an end date, an interval, a period in here. I would just like to download as much daily data as I can. And then since we're just going to be looking at the price, I chose to only take the close, and we've plotted it, and it looks exactly as you'd expect. That is the S&P 500. So the next thing that I did was just to get a feel for the AD Fuller test. We took the AD Fuller and checked it on the S&P 500 raw data. Now, the test statistic is positive, which generally a good ADF test is going to have some critical statistic that's negative. And our p-value is 8.98, which is not anywhere near any type of critical value that lets you reject the null, meaning this is not stationary and the null remains. So the next thing is to look at the log price. And so what we did was just transform into log, the log price, and plot it again. And we took a look at the ADF for the log price, which is a little bit better than when it's just the original price, raw data, but still we could not reject the null. And also the ADF at zero is the statistic, and the ADF at one is the p-value. So now we can go and look at what it is just to like take the returns. We're going to difference by an order of one, just like everybody who's ever done this will do. And it's the first thing you learn how to do when working with financial data, besides maybe plot it. And so we take the S&P 500 price and we subtract the S&P 500 shifted one, which is just take current price, subtract it by the previous price. And we did that with the log returns as well. And then we plotted them and took the ADF test for both. And what you'll notice is both are very negative and the p-value is incredibly small, meaning we can reject the null and say that this is in fact stationary now. Now, when you look at this though, it just even visually doesn't look like it's going to give you a ton of information. Is how am I going to get an edge that isn't already being exploited by the masses when I just have a mean, a standard deviation, and this series of returns that there's no memory, there's no nothing, it's just, we've basically flushed out all the important information left. And when working with something like machine learning, I kind of want that information. I'd like to see if we can find patterns or figure something out. And so this is where fractionally differencing comes in. And if you go over to our Medium article, you'll be able to see the actual mathematical notation and deeper explanations into the formulas and how it ends up working. Here we're going to skip that and just work with it, because you can take this, plug it in, try it, test it, just get familiar with it. And then if you want more detail, you can obviously go over to our Medium, read that, find articles online to take you a little more down the rabbit hole. But essentially, it is a binomial series of a backshift operator. And so when I think before explaining these first functions, it is best to take a look at what's already plotted, because we've already went over that what we usually do is differencing by an order of one. And what you'll notice is we've also plotted now differencing by fractional orders. And so what this means is at a lag of zero, so our current price, the weight is one. And then at a lag of one, meaning the next price, so the previous price, has a weight of negative one. And then it goes to zero, and it's zero for the rest. And that looks like this. If the current price is 100, we'd multiply it by 1. If the price prior to this price was 99, we'd multiply it by negative 1. This would, when summed together, give us 100 minus 99. This is differencing at an order of 1. And it's exactly what we saw when we did the returns. So if we took a fraction of this, you'll notice that it goes 1, negative 0.75, negative 0.15, and then so on until it goes to 0. And so basically all we're doing is finding the weights that are going to be multiplied with the prices and summed together. And that's what the gist of fractional differencing is. And so in our function for get weights, we put in D, which is the order we'd like to difference at, and we put in how many lags, which means at what cutoff of historical closing data would we like to look back at. And so we start with one, and then we apply the formula that is in better detail explained on the Medium article for fractional differencing. We reshape it and we return the array. And on the plot weights, you put in your array of 0 and 1 here, which is where you'd like to start for the differencing order and where you'd like to end. You put in how many lags you'd like, which we chose 20, and then how many plots, which you'll notice that this goes into an interval using the MP lin space, and it shows from the start to the stop, and we take linear steps. And that's what you're seeing in terms of the differencing order from 0, 0.25, 0.5, 0.75. It's increments of 0.25. So the next thing is the time series differencing. And the time series differencing is just going to get their weights up until some cutoff that we've defined. And that's going to be a lag cutoff. And we're going to put the order in. And this will allow us to fractionally difference a time series. And so this is what it ends up looking like. The S&P 500 regular raw data, not log, with 0.8 as our differencing order and 20 lags, ends up looking something like this. And as you can tell when we take the ADF test, the p-value is below the threshold at which we could reject the null and say that this is stationary. And what's interesting about that is before doing anything and just playing around with this, we can see that we didn't have to difference all the way to an order of one in order to make stationary time series data. And so along with that, we played around with the log and got the same results. And we can upgrade what we just did by building a function that finds the proper cutoff. And so in here, we're going to take a starting lag. We're going to take some cutoff, which is going to be a very small number. We're going to use 1e⁵5. And you'll take the order, which is the differencing order you'd like. And what it's going to do is it's going to get the weights, put the value as the last weight, and then we're going to keep incrementing our lag from the start lag up +1, +1, +1 until we've dropped below the cutoff that we set. And so this will return the lags, the proper amount of lags to achieve what we'd like to achieve. And so we made another function, which is the TS differencing cutoff, where you put the series in, you put the order in, and then you put your cutoff in, and it'll return the same thing as the first function did, and do the exact same thing. We've just better optimized for the lags that we need to use. And in order to show sort of what this is capable of, and to show how big of a difference sometimes fractionally differencing can be, and how much we over-difference and reduce a lot of the memory that we don't have to, I've taken a ton of different differencing orders. We've made our cutoff in the variable tau, which is 1e⁵, and then we've just made an array for the log ADF stat holder. We've went through all of these using the TS differencing cutoff function to take the ADF, and we're just funneling all the p-values for that, as you can see by 1, into this array so that we can plot it later to see around where it does go under that threshold we set. And so when you plot this, you start to see that at 0.4 for your differencing order is where it becomes stationary. And 0.4, to achieve what you set out to achieve in making the time series stationary, is much less than 1. And so when we go look at this, we take the log S&P 500 close, we difference by an order of 0.4 with a threshold of 1e⁵5. And when we take a look at the ADF statistic and the ADF p-value, we can reject the null and see that it is stationary. And this is what it ends up looking like. And so basically, we get to retain a whole lot more memory, which might become valuable when we're applying some other thing like machine learning. And we make sure that it meets the qualifications that it needs to, which is being stationary. We just didn't strip it of all the valuable stuff. And so I definitely urge you guys to play around with this, see what you can do with it. Take some time to mess around with different stocks or assets and different data. Apply it to machine learning, apply it to whatever you'd like to apply it to, and feel free to leave a comment. Let us know what you're working on. Let us know what you'd like to see next. But we'd like to generate a nice quant community of people who are just discussing ideas and helping each other out. So take this, do what you'd like with it. We'll be back with 3 more videos this week, and I guess we'll see you then. Feel free to like, comment, and subscribe, and have a good time searching for your alpha.